Series conversation, program title number Krishna. Air date to be announced, date recorded 6/29/76. Director Connor.
Hello, I'm Mike Gannon, and this is Conversation. One of the oldest questions that man has posed to himself, is, if it is not the oldest question of all, is, what is life? It is a fundamental, ultimate kind of question. And it is a question that man continues to ask and to ponder in the fields of science, philosophy, and religion. It's the kind of question, with associated other questions, that we will be asking on this conversation. And I'll be back in a moment with my guests.
Conversation, a discussion of social, political, scientific, and religious issues of the day. Your host is Dr. Michael V. Gannon, professor of religion and history at the University of Florida.
My guests on this conversation are Dr. Richard Thompson. He holds his doctorate in mathematics from Cornell University. And Dr. Svarupa Damodara, who holds his doctorate in physical organic chemistry from the University of California. Welcome to Conversation, gentlemen. And one thing more that I want to say is something very important about you both, namely that you are members of the International Society of Krishna Consciousness. And I think that it would be very important before we begin to discuss some of the questions to which I alluded in our opening remarks, I think it would be very important if we talked about Krishna consciousness for a moment, what it means, not only to you, but to the movement itself. Dr. Thompson, would you begin for us, please?
Well, Krishna consciousness is the science of understanding the nature of the self, and the nature of God, and the nature of the relation between the two. And this science is recorded in the Vedic literature of India and has been passed down since time immemorial through a disciplic succession of spiritual masters. Mm-hmm. So essentially the Krishna consciousness, the object is to attain self-realization and knowledge of God.
Now, most people know of Krishna consciousness by a more popular term, the Hare Krishna movement. Could you tell me what Hare Krishna means?
Well, Hare Krishna, these are names of God. It's explained in the Vedas that in this age, this particular period in history, the best way to self-realization is by chanting the names of God. And so people commonly see us doing this in public.
Yes,
and
all right.
The Hare Krishna mantra.
The mantra is the word or the phrase. And what does it mean, the Hare Krishna mantra? What does it mean in translation?
Well, Hare and Krishna, these are names of God in Sanskrit.
All right. Now, Dr. Svarupa Damodara.
Yes.
You are a member of the Krishna movement or member of Krishna consciousness, and at the same time, you are, like Dr. Thompson, a publishing active physical scientist. Well, how do you relate those two in your personal life and in your professional life?
Well, actually, one can learn the science of the self, or in Sanskrit it's called Atma, or Atma Gyan in Sanskrit. Gyan means knowledge, Atma means the individual self. So the relationship between the individual self and the supreme self, that is called Paramatma, is the actually ultimate science. If one analyzes very carefully, one should come to the understanding that, yes, this science, the relationship between the individual self and the Paramatma, the super self, must be the ultimate science. That is actually pure knowledge. So now we study chemistry, physics, mathematics, is physical sciences. But the ultimate aim is to understand what is nature and what is the relationship. Is there any creator or just nature is just void, meaningless? So these things are very important fundamental questions.
Yes, and I suppose that the most fundamental question of all is, what is this life in which we're all engaged? And what are some of the problems associated with life as you see them in contemporary society?
in our modern society, you see, the modern society actually is controlled by scientists. Mm-hmm. If a scientist, a famous scientist, says something today, then people will tend to believe in. It's quite natural because we are so much influenced by our modern scientific and technological findings.
Yes.
In a sense, true. But now, the most fundamental mistake at this time is that they profess, just without any scientific background, that life actually is a manifestation of matter.
Life is a manifestation of matter, that according to the majority of physical scientists.
Yes, that's right.
Well, I take your word for that. I have not made a study of how many physical scientists hold that particular view. I wonder if you could elucidate a little bit on it, and Dr. Thompson, please join in this conversation at any time if you think that we need to elaborate. But please tell me why you say that the majority of physical scientists believe that life is a manifestation of matter.
Yes, that's what actually you'll find, especially those scientists working in the areas of biology, in the areas of biochemistry, in the areas of chemistry, and in almost all areas. Especially you will find a textbook written by a collection of biologists, especially in this country. It's called Molecules to Man.
It's Molecules to Man.
Man. You know, that book is taught actually right from schools to colleges to the university level. And the fundamental point is there that life just comes from molecules. That is the ultimate meaning of life.
All right. Now, you're talking then about the chance combination of molecules.
That's
to form
right.
Basic, amino acids and life cells?
Yes, amino acids, then molecules built into DNA.
DNA.
Yes.
About which we have all read much recently.
Yes.
Well, Dr. Thompson, let me turn to probability mathematics. You are a mathematician, and I would assume that you are disputing the possibility that molecules could combine in some primordial muck or ooze or soup to form basic structures that could manifest life. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. Actually, if you look at this question very carefully from the point of view of mathematics, you find practically no support for the concept that life could come about by chance combinations and simple physical laws. The basic idea of the origin of life, which is proposed, is that you have simple physical laws given by equations of force, like the electrical force, magnetic interactions, and so on. And along with that, along with those simple laws, you have chance. And these things together should cause molecules at random to organize into complicated structures like these living bodies. But if you look at this from the point of view of information theory and mathematics, you can conclude very definitely that this is not possible.
I see. I remember that back in the very late 40s or early 1950s, Dr. Lecomte-Nui at the Rockefeller Institute in New York demonstrated, to his satisfaction at least, that according to the known age of the Earth at that particular time, not enough time would permit the molecules to combine in the complex or the complexity required to form life cells.
Yes, this is a very important point. One of the basic arguments that is made by evolutionists and people who advocate origin of life from molecules is that even though events of great improbability are involved, if you wait for a long enough time, they're bound to happen. This is an argument that's often repeated.
Yes, that so if you put a monkey at the typewriter and give him enough time, eons of time, eventually he will type out Hamlet.
So it's very instructive to try to compute just how much time would be needed. Mm-hmm. And just to give one very simple example, this is quite elementary, so one can go over it briefly. You can ask the expected time for a protein molecule to form to within a given specification. Actually, we did a calculation of the time required for a protein molecule to come within 10% of a specific protein, such as you find in a living being. And the estimated time from probability theory comes to 10 to the 167th power billion years.
Mm-hmm. Far beyond the projected age of the universe that we know.
They only estimate the age of the Earth to be some 4.5 billion years. Mm-hmm. And comparing that to 10 to the 167 is 1 followed by 167 zeros. That many billions of years you would expect to wait before the formation of such a thing at random.
Well, now, your objection there depends on the acceptance of the known age of the Earth. Mm-hmm. And yet, have you not, in various of your writings, criticized dating processes and procedures, such as carbon-14 dating? And if you have criticized these procedures as dubious in nature, then one of the principles of your argument must also be called into question, don't you think? Namely, that you're using the known age of the Earth.
Well, actually, the basic argument we want to make is a positive one. Mm-hmm. We must, of course, point out defects in these different scientific theories. But we have a basic positive argument that we would like to put across. And this also is very, very ancient. Namely, that the cause of a phenomenon must have within it all of the properties and qualities and characteristics of the phenomenon which is produced. Mm-hmm. In other words, whatever is in the effect must be there in the cause. And this can actually be demonstrated by means of information theory in particular.
That principle that the effect cannot be greater than the cause is an old one, isn't it? In Western philosophy, Aristotle proposed it, and Thomas Aquinas developed it in medieval philosophy. Now, you are arguing that there is no possibility, given the information presently in hand, to support the supposition that order can come from disorder, or that life can come from inert matter. But what about the process of evolution once life does appear? Do you also find that a tenable theory or fact?
Well, once again, if you look at this basic principle of the cause and the effect, suppose you have a single cell like a bacterium, a living being. There's the question, can this evolve over some period of time into a human being? Once again, we would like to point out that the cause, the ultimate cause behind these manifestations, must have within it all of the properties of the ultimate effect, such as the evolution of the human being. So the same argument applies. So the idea that by chance mutations and a mere interaction in the environment due to physical laws could not produce the evolution of higher orders of complexity.
All right, let me turn to you, Dr. Svarupa Damodara, and ask, why is that a necessary conclusion? Because biologists and those who work in the field of evolutionary science are committed to the theory that higher forms do evolve from lower forms, and that there is already a principle of complexity in the lower form which makes the higher form possible. Why cannot one accept that?
That's a very important question. And the fundamental difficulty in knowing that, especially in the minds of the scientists, is that they do not know the basic fundamental point that what is life.
Yes.
That is the whole trouble and the whole difficulty of actually proposing this theory. If they actually know what life is, then there's no way that they can say like that. So we propose, we take the knowledge from the Vedas. Vedas are the ancient scriptures in Vedic literature. Vedas very clearly define what life is. And there it is stated that life is non-physical and non-chemical. Mm-hmm. So actually it is beyond our physical manipulations.
Well, you're taking the religious principles of the Veda and applying them a priori to the scientific findings?
Yes, actually this can be supported and this can be understood.
Mm-hmm. See, this, one might say religious principles, but actually one can make a scientific hypothesis that life is non-physical and non-chemical. This can be investigated scientifically like any other question. And so we're proposing that the scientific evidence stacks up in favor of this proposition.
Well, how would you define life then? If life is non-physical and non-chemical, what is it? I'm sure that everyone would like to know how you understand life to be.
Mm-hmm. Well, of course, the traditional method in science has been reduction of the object of study down to simple components. And what we're essentially proposing is that this cannot be done with life. So in that sense, you cannot define it. But you can say some of the properties and characteristics of life. One thing is consciousness.
Consciousness, and the ability to think and to reflect on oneself and so
and
on.
To be aware. Mm-hmm. Yes. One basic point we might bring up here is that even in modern physics, consciousness has been found to play an essential role. And this isn't too widely recognized. But even von Neumann, back in the 1930s in his analysis of quantum theory, which is the dominant theory in modern physics, realized that the consciousness is a non-physical entity. That is, the physical equations of quantum mechanics were not able to encompass the observer of a physical system. The observer always remained outside.
Yes.
And yet the function of observation was essential in the quantum mechanical system. So one basic point we'd like to make is that life has the property of consciousness, whereas matter does not have this property.
What are some of the visible or tangible or otherwise identifiable properties of consciousness? Would they be thought systems, love, willing, voluntary action?
Yes, all the characteristics of personality are involved with consciousness. The philosophy we are proposing says that ultimately the spiritual reality is one of personal form and activity, ultimately based on love, love between the individual soul and God. So reducing this to a scientific statement, we would expect that consciousness would be associated with all the different manifestations of personality.
Mm-hmm. So I understand from something that you said earlier that you see a limit to man's ability to observe through scientific methodology the realities of life, but not only life, the inner workings of matter itself. I suppose you mean by that the ideas proposed by Heisenberg in the uncertainty principle, that the very act of observing disturbs the thing observed?
Yes, that's one aspect. Also, another important aspect is that in mathematics, it is possible actually to examine the frontiers of mathematics from within mathematics and see the limits which are imposed on principle on what can be done with mathematical reasoning. For example, Gödel, German mathematician Gödel, proved that there are certain limits to what you can do with an axiomatic system. And much more modern research has defined these limits more closely. And it can be seen that I should briefly say that in a mathematical system you have a set of axioms which are taken as unproved. And from the axioms you infer different conclusions. And then the scientific method is you take a given conclusion and you compare it with the physical object of study and make an observation. Well, mathematically it is shown that many systems involve an unlimited number of axioms in order to specify them. This was what Gödel proved, in particular for number theory. And so the traditional idea of physics has been that we could get by with very few axioms, because the axioms are a problem because we cannot prove them. We have to arrive at them somehow. But these results in mathematics imply an unlimited number of axioms. And so this puts a basic limitation on what can be done with the mind and the process of observation.
Well, Dr. Svarupa Damodara, do you believe that you have identified with the Krishna consciousness as a way of going beyond the limits of the physical sciences to a deeper understanding, not only of life, but of ultimate reality itself?
Definitely.
Perhaps even a deeper understanding of matter.
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. Could you explain that? Why do you get a deeper understanding of matter?
First of all, just like Richard Thompson has mentioned about axioms, you know, that's a very important concept. So getting knowledge, what is the source of knowledge? One should inquire first. Now, in the Vedas, I still refer to the Vedas. Vedas say that in order to understand this basic subject matter of matter and life, one should at least have some idea of the absolute truth. What is that absolute truth? And how does it like? How does it behave? What are its qualities and its symptoms? So one must have at least some understanding of the absolute truth. That is a prerequisite in order to understand purely what is the matter and what is life. Then one, when the one develops that little understanding, then one can see things very clearly in its true form, perspective. Mm-hmm. One can see very truly what is matter and what is life. What is the difference? There is a fundamental difference. So the Vedas further instruct that, yes, that absolute truth is a divine personality.
Mm-hmm.
He has a divine form. And it is mentioned in the one of the most famous books, textbooks in the Vedas called Vedanta Sutra. It says in Sanskrit, it says, Janma dasa jataha. The absolute truth is that from which everything comes. So actually, matter also comes from the absolute truth. Life also comes from the absolute truth.
Now, does Krishna consciousness enable a person such as yourself to identify with absolute truth and then have a deeper understanding of what, passing truth or scientific truth?
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. You understand what is absolute truth. And then actually you relate everything to absolute truth. There is some sort of axiomatic statement. You cannot prove exactly what the absolute truth looks like, but there are symptoms that you can take and can relate.
I even see similarities with philosophical and religious systems that have been developed in the West, and I think in particular of St. Augustine of Hippo in the 5th century, 4th and 5th centuries, and St. Anselm in the 12th century, both of whom posited the principle, credo ut intelligam, I believe that I might understand. And they had the same fundamental conception that if you identified with absolute truth, you would understand the less absolute. But I know that this is not to say that similarities are identities and that these visions of absolute truth were the same. What you're saying is something unique in particular to your tradition. But I'd like to know now, if I could turn again to Dr. Thompson, what that tradition has to say about the admitted successes of the physical sciences in mastering certain laws or certain systems of laws and enabling us to have the kind of technological civilization that we do. I think that most people are, if not intimidated, certainly awed by the successes of the physical sciences. Now, you're not arguing that these successes are unreal. You're simply arguing that the physical sciences, scientists, have carried their principles too far into the realm of religion and life. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. If we look, for example, at the principles of physics and chemistry, that's the main area where such impressive advances have been made. We see actually that these various physical laws apply only on a very limited scale. For example, in physics, one performs experiments involving spectroscopy, bombardment of nuclear particles with other particles. In chemistry, there's a combination of different compounds. And by studying these things, different simple laws have been devised, such as the laws of quantum mechanics. However, to say that these laws are universal truths and to extrapolate them through time and space to apply to everything is completely unwarranted. Actually, if we look, for example, at the equations of quantum mechanics, we find that they cannot even be solved for molecules of even fairly low complexity. For example, if you even go to the diatomic hydrogen molecule, the simplest molecule, you have to use many different approximations and assumptions to handle that because the mathematics becomes hard. If you then go to a bigger molecule, such as ammonia or quinine or something like that, it becomes practically impossible. And if you then go to the kinds of molecules that are found in living systems, no one even dreams of applying these theories to those, much less to an entire body. But yet, the tendency is to extrapolate these laws universally. But what we'd like to propose is that actually, these laws are applicable only in limited conditions, and that there are many higher order laws acting.
Mm-hmm. I see. You adopt a holistic approach, I understand. Could you describe what that means? A holistic approach?
Well, I believe the word holistic was used in that article there. But basically, the understanding we have is that essentially this world is a manifestation of the absolute truth, which is the complete whole.
All right.
And these different manifestations of matter form one aspect of this complete whole, which these things that we manipulate in the laboratory.
All right, now I'd like to ask about matter. Mm-hmm. What is matter? We've asked the question, what is life? What are some of the laws and some of the manifestations that we see associated with life? But what is matter? If I put my hand on this table, I am inclined to say that that is matter. But even an Aristotelian philosopher would say, no, I have not touched matter. Matter is an intellectual principle, and matter has no manifestation until it possesses form. And yet, A man like Carl Jung will go even beyond that and say that matter is fundamentally spiritual. And I understand that your position is very close to that. Is that right, Dr. Svarupa Damodara?
We'll make a distinction. Matter, we define, that we take from the Vedas, is the inferior energy of the absolute truth. There are two types of energy. One is called the inferior energy of the absolute truth.
Infinite energy?
Inferior.
Inferior, I'm sorry.
Yes. And the other one is called superior energy.
Superior energies
are the living entities. Now, in a sense, Carl Jung might be right saying that matter is also a spiritual source. That's why we mentioned earlier that both energies come from the same source. So in that sense, it has a spiritual significance, but still there is a fundamental difference. Mm-hmm. This is matter. This is inferior energy. But now, this matter, unless it is touched by a living entity, then actually matter cannot take forms mm-hmm. or shapes. Mm-hmm. So the touch of a living entity is a prerequisite in order to have that definite form mm-hmm. of that matter.
But you do not deny, according to our contemporary scientific insights, that this table is composed of atoms and molecules and all of the associated elements that go to make up the material world. Yet even atoms and molecules might be part of a spiritual dimension that we do not yet quite understand. Or do we understand it?
Actually, ultimately, it is said that even within the atom, the spiritual force is working. It's called Paramatma, the super soul, actually is acting in its atom also.
I see.
Without his sanction, actually, nothing can move.
I see. Now, I said at the very beginning that I wondered why you had gotten interested in this particular movement. Dr. Thompson, were you led into the Krishna movement because of disaffection with scientific method or with disenchantment with the technological world in which you live? Would you care to tell us a little bit in the brief time we have remaining about your personal commitment here and the reasons behind it?
Well, yes, actually, there was a certain disaffection with science. Actually, I was pursuing science with the object of finding out, you know, what the actual truth was, what's really going on in the world. And so I pursued this through, I started out in biology. I went through physics and finally studied mathematics because that seemed to be the most basic aspect of science. And I finally became quite disenchanted with science when I found that its fundamental teaching was that everything was simply a combination, essentially can be reduced to a combination of numbers. Mm-hmm. For example, you can see that's the basic principle of modern science, like physics. We have these atoms and molecules. We reduce them to equations. And so in the end, everything is reduced to numbers. And that means you and me also are reduced just to a combination of numbers that are just interacting in a blind mechanical way. And so I strongly felt that something was missing there, that this was not satisfactory.
And Dr. Svarupa Damodara, the same? Or have you been in Krishna consciousness for a longer time?
Yes. From the very beginning, when I became conscious of the outside world, I was always interested in the absolute truth.
Yes.
And now when you pursue science, normally science is supposed to give you the answer, especially the physical sciences, what is the nature of the cosmos and what is the nature of everything around us. But now, as you progress, we found out that the scientists are professing that given enough length of time, then everything is going bound to happen.
But you do not believe that. And I thank you both for being on Conversation. Dr. Richard Thompson, who holds his doctorate in mathematics from Cornell University, Dr. Svarupa Damodara, a doctorate in organic chemistry from the University of California, both visiting the campus of the University of Florida. I'm Mike Gannon, and this has been Conversation.